was missing something. All right. Good day, everyone, whether it's your early morning, really, really early morning, or like us here in San Diego, we're just at 7 p.m. here. We're starting our evening. If you caught our conversation, we've been having a lot of overcast weather, gloomy, cloudy, but the sun is finally out today, so we're getting a little bit of energy before the sun goes hiding again. Today is our last session in this series, and as mentioned, I'm really sad. I really look forward to these weekly sessions and doing the checking everybody's assignment. I was surprised that we got only one talent in the group chat. So I don't know what happened. I was going to send out a message, reminder, but then I forgot. I got busy too. But anyway, we were talking about our talents. We'll wrap things up tonight. We might get done early. We'll see. If not, we'll be here to answer any questions. I'll leave the wrap up and the review for the end, since this is the end of our program. I'm going to open share my worksheet. Please give me a little time to switch my screen. And we go in here. There, I just need to set up my different screens. So last week, we mainly concentrated on the character traits of or treasure of generosity. That's what we talked about, how generosity helps us to become a better person. We have to be generous. We cannot be selfish. Otherwise, all the other good qualities will just fade away and we'll be left with nothing but being selfish. Some of the acts that we can do to bring joy and happiness to others, and also how we need to plan for our future. For some of our young participants, it might be a distant future. If you're in your 20s or 30s, you're probably just starting your working years. But as we saw in that table, really starting at age 25 or at age 35 makes a huge difference in our saving for retirement. And saving for future and making ourselves happy, basically that's what retirement is. And retirement is no different than really the developing the habit of saving. That's what it is. But as we saw, saving is usually when we put money in a bank account for short-term goals. Let's say if you want to buy a laptop, if you want to buy a car, or if you want to buy a house, something like that. Anything that we want to buy that we want to save, that's where usually we keep it in a savings. But then and savings doesn't have any risk. Well, in most countries, let me rephrase that, because we have a fairly good economic system here in the U.S., and I can't remember for how long, but our savings has been saved. It is insured by the federal government. So for people to really lose their savings in their bank accounts in the U.S., the whole country has to go bankrupt. But we do know that this is not the case in other countries. There are other countries that their value of their currency keeps declining. I was talking to a friend in Zimbabwe, and he said that it is so bad that a lot of people are just migrating out of Zimbabwe into South Africa. He migrated to Australia. He said it's really bad. Their currency keeps losing value. So saving for retirement is just basically setting some money aside, having the discipline, not spending everything that we have right now and thinking about the future. That's what we need to do. And also investing. So keeping money in a savings account cannot really count towards retirement because it needs investment, whether it's in real estate, in stock market, in bonds, whatever is available, in farmland, weather is available in your country. So it's really depending on where we live. This exercise here, election process for class representatives. This is one that we normally use in the schools. So what we do, and I think I've mentioned most of the time, here locally, we are presenting this curriculum to students in primary school, starting from grade 3. And what we have seen is that they are really ready to receive this information. They need to develop this education from such a young age. So that's why we love working in schools, in primary schools. Another reason for working with students in primary school is that parents are mostly still connected with their children. At least this is the case that we see here in the US. I'm not sure how it is in other countries, but even as parents ourselves, my wife and I remember that while our children were in primary school, as we call it, elementary school here, we would look at their homework, their assignment, what's happening to them at school, would ask them, would be very much involved. We would volunteer in school. But once they started grade 6 and 7 and higher, they became just kind of on their own. And that's why we really think that presenting this education to young people is very important. So when we do this in groups, we usually allow the group to elect representatives that are going to make a presentation in like a class assembly or school assembly. So that's what this is. A lot of it is about an our election process, which is described in the facilitator manual, is not about people nominating themselves or telling people, I'm going to be a good representative. We actually don't allow any propaganda or any nomination. We basically have the participants, we talk about what are some of the good qualities that our representatives should have. Irma, since you're familiar with this, what are some of the good qualities that your students usually come up with in your classes?
I didn't hear the last part you said.
So the question is, when you do this in your classes, what are some of the good qualities that students have come up with for their representatives to have?
Oh, some of their ability to communicate. They find it really important because the students will have to present an overview of what our program is. So the students are pretty good about nominating people that have good communication skills.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. Also, Julie, what about you? What are some of the good qualities that your students have come up with for this process?
Well, the ability to listen to the teacher, to understand the instructions, and being respectful. They use respectful a lot. That was my favorite one, to be respectful.
Okay, all right. The ones I usually come across is like the representative needs to have courage because it's not easy to get up in front of people. It's always, I always feel that the students have butterflies in them. Have a strong voice, not a loud voice, but a strong voice. Be responsible because they're supposed to come up with like a paragraph. Sometimes they just do a simple paragraph. But some mm-hmm. have gone as far as like creating a play, maybe a board or something like that. And this is when we usually invite the parents to come. So when we do this in schools, we invite the parents to come, their school mates. And it's a completely a different election process because what we see in our society today is that those who want to be elected, they do a lot of propaganda. They make a lot of promises. Even when they do mean well, we know that sometimes the system does not allow them to do this. So that's what this election process is. I don't think we need to spend more time on it. All right, let's get into the next treasure, which is truthfulness. All right, so in the chat, I'm going to put a question and anybody who would like to open your microphone and respond to this question. Do you think our generation is truthful and honest or not? What are your thoughts generally in your society, in what you see on TV, on social media? Do we see a lot of truthfulness and honesty or not? Who is Daniel? Want to share something? Malopi? I see you're unmuted. Sophia, go ahead.
Yeah, I based on my observation, I think in our generation, the honest is really limited. We are mostly living on a fake society, especially like people try to show off something that is not really what they do, what are they, but just only to be fake in social media.
Okay, all right. Maria also says from US, Maria says there seems to be a lot of dishonesty, especially in social media. There's a lot of fake news. Yes, exactly. Let's see, who do we have from other countries? I guess Malopi is having some problem with his. Malopi, if you're talking, if you talk, we couldn't hear you. I see that your microphone is unmuted, but we cannot hear you. Yeah, this is very unfortunate that our society has become very much dishonest. Vicky from Uganda says, not really. Our generation is not truthful, and there is a lot of dishonesty, especially in public offices. That is unfortunately the truth, that everybody is just thinking about themselves, and that often means to deceive other people, whether it's trying to sell something, an investment, or other things. And this is one of the two quotes that are here. Truthfulness is the foundation of all human virtues and independent investigation of truth. These are both from the Baha'i writings. And it basically, and what we do in class actually, we talk about the foundation. What's the foundation of the building? So for this lesson plan, there is really nothing that I could have our virtual series do. But we will talk about how we can see the sea. Okay, Malopi says there's a lot of misinformation going around, often full of untruth. Yes, exactly. And it seems like it's getting worse and worse. Irma, what do you think? How would you describe our societies?
Well, what really concerns me tremendously is that the, you know, young people, you know, that grew up on social media, you know, they are conditioned to present a very false impression of themselves to the world. And so if you are constantly exercising this way of presenting yourself to the world with, you know, with no flaws, you know, these young ladies, you know, they try to present, you know, perfection, you know, in the way that, you know, they take photographs of themselves. And this is a big thing, right? It's a big deal. And now we find out that entire way of thinking is so harmful for these young people now. You know, it's driving them to, you know, mental illness and all kinds of different problems in society. And it all the, you know, the root is in dishonesty. The root of that is being dishonest and trying to portray yourself as something that you're not. I think that's very sad.
Yes, exactly. So how do we see? So this is a question for the group. Again, you can unmute yourself or put it in the chat. How do you think we are getting? Where do we see truthfulness? How does this affecting our finances, our financial affairs? But my computer is a little slow. Like when we go shopping, let's see if any of the participants would like to put something in the chat or open your microphone. How does this lack of truthfulness and honesty is affecting our financial affairs and financial progress? Any ideas? What you see in your countries? Daniel, if you're talking, Malopi, if you're talking, we cannot hear you. Something is wrong with your microphone today. Okay. Ms. Banks, what do you think? What do you see that, how is this dishonesty affecting our finances?
Well, I would say when you're at false advertisement, just a simple thing like when the phone rings and it says scam alert, or the people are out there trying to take people's money by lying and stealing. And it's just, I mean, especially with the elder group and the get money fast, and you, and they call you into your home, they come into your home on the phone, and they're, and a lot of people are falling for this, these scams. Mm-hmm. Or they say the bananas cost $1.99, you get there and they're $3.99. So that's false advertisement also.
Okay, all right, yes. So is this happening in other societies or not? I would love to hear, because in our society, in the US market, a lot of deception is happening. There's like things that it's not a lie, but the merchants, the stores, they portray things as like, well, you have to buy, it says like big red letters. It says two for, let's say, $2. But then if you only need one of it, I'm not sure what we can buy with a dollar anymore, but these are the things that that's happening, and we see a lot. That's actually what we have seen. I'll pull this up. And the way we've connected this honest truthfulness and with honesty and our shopping is, so if you remember in the moderation lesson, we created a shopping list. I'm not sure if I have any money, any items in there. So in moderation, when we work with students, we created a shopping list, and we put in items in here. I should have filled this up. And we told them that let's keep on these items. And then once we have enough money, which would be about once we get to the truthful lesson, then we'll go shopping. And the way we go shopping, I think I've shown this. Yes, I know it's not gonna work with you. This is one of the ways that we can do shopping. That works for us here in the US. It's basically we put in our zip code and it pulls up different store ads from different stores that we can see. Is there, while I'm doing this, are there ways for people in different countries? Do you have ways of doing comparison shopping, either on the internet or by comparing prices in stores? I don't think we've ever asked that. Can friends from Cambodia or Africa share some thoughts? I'll let pull this up.
Can you repeat the question again, please?
Yes, yeah. The question is that, Sophia, do you have, can you do compare shopping? So before we go to stores, is there any way for you guys, let's say if you want to buy meat, can you compare to see which store has a better price or not? Or you basically go to one store and buy whatever you need?
Finally, comparison we only do by
your voice is cutting in and out. Right. Sophia, your voice is Ricky, go ahead. I'm not sure why everybody's having trouble with their sound today. Ricky, we see that your microphone is unmuted, but you know we cannot hear you. Okay. All right, so this is one of the, I'm gonna pull this up. This is one of the examples of how we get deceived in our markets. So this one says, it's some type of a pre-made food. It says 2 for $6. And as you saw, I'll go back up here, but then it also says $3 each. So this is how we get deceived in the market. When I look at here, it says big, bold, red leather. It says 2 for $6. So it kind of makes me think that I have to buy both of them. But then when I go into the ad, it says, no, it's $3 each. And these are the things that we work with our students. And really enjoyed this. We actually bring some of these papers or do this shopping so they get a feel of how to shop for their weekly needs. Okay, Sophia says, we only do it by our experience and personal shopping. Okay, all right, so that's what they have. Vicky says, yes, I do make comparison before going for shopping to help me not be cheated by the seller. Very good. So it's a global problem. All the issues that we have, it's a global problem. And the other things that we see in US is that when we go to supermarket, and I think I've seen this all around the world, different places that we have traveled, is that life essential, the essential things that we need to buy, like milk, that is usually at the end of the store. We have to walk through all the aisles that has chips, other junk food, other things, and even where they place the different items. So items that are appealing to children usually are set in the lower shelves. And then items that are appealing to adults is on at their eye level. And there's a lot of thought that goes into where everything is placed at. And these are usually in the bigger supermarkets. I think smaller mom and pops usually don't maybe pay attention that much to things. So it's really important for us to keep an eye on that, make a shopping list. I don't think we asked us, who actually makes your shopping list? In the chat. Okay, so Maria says, I do. And why? Why is it that we make shopping lists? What's the benefit of making a shopping list? Yes, Maria says, help me not to overbuy. She passes sometimes. Let's see. Maria says, especially when I'm hungry. Yes, yeah, definitely. We have this big store here. It's called Costco. I know it does exist in other parts of the world. And they don't sell stuff that are small. Everything you buy at Costco is big. So I used to actually have a to buy list and also not to buy, just to make sure I don't buy more than, because I would think, I'm not kidding. Several times I bought a big jar of mayonnaise, thinking that we don't have enough at home. And it was just, this was even before the kid. I would come home and we already have like a big jar of mayonnaise. So I started doing that. Okay, Vicky says, yes, I did to help me control misdirected priorities. Yes, so you see that's why we had this shopping list. If we really didn't talk about it, not only it helps us create that balance, but also not to buy and buy what we need, and to make sure that we can we buy based on our budget of how much money we have. And this is really helpful. All right. What else do we do? Emma or Judy, about untruthfulness? I think that's the big activity that we do.
Truthfulness, yeah, that's it.
Yeah. For the building a foundation, we usually bring in building blocks like
recording blocks. In progress.
So we do use that. So we help the participants learn what is the strong foundation, what is not. Let's talk about this. I think was it Emma or somebody else mentioned? This one right here, this sentence, if I can highlight it. Have you ever found yourself try to be somebody who's who you're not just to impress others? Have you ever been in a situation like that or found yourself trying to impress others with things that you don't have? Judy is smiling. I think that's a yes. Judy, you want to tell us what you did while we're waiting for others to put something in the chat?
Not so much as me, Alex, but my sons, we've got to have the iPhone 13. They, you know, a flip-flop will do good for me, but they get me. I said, but Mom, you need the name brand shoes. And I go, no, I don't. You know, so, and they, that makes them feel good about their self and trying to impress people with what they have. My sons are good for that.
Okay, all right. So I put that in the chat. Have you ever tried to impress anybody and buy something that you definitely didn't have? And for us here in US, it's very easy, or any country that there is the borrowing system, like the credit card. Borrowing system can be a great tool for investing if it's used the right way. But then it can be also very bad. So Aria says, yes, she has purchased something to impress others. What about, have you ever been criticized for being a smart shopper? Let's talk about that. Or doing something that's not normal to other people that helped you save money. And if yes, share something. So the question is, have you, good morning, Alcina.
Good morning.
Thank you for joining us. So the question to everyone is, have you ever, what was the question now? I forgot.
Tried to impress others.
No, that was to impress others, but no, the other one. Have you done things that it just, you think it's right, and particularly in relation to money, like try to save money or do something like that, and people have given you a hard time. Then why are you doing this? Why aren't you just spending lavishly? Has that ever happened to anyone? Everybody's quiet. All right. Well, I love doing that stuff because a lot of things I do differently than others. Steve Fast said, yes, criticism was that I wasted more time making a spreadsheet of grocery prices. Steve Fast, are you talking about me or yourself? okay. But if you remember, I do have a spreadsheet for everything. Everything that I want to buy, I have a spreadsheet about it. Other things that I've been criticized about is I love drying, hanging the clothes outside and letting it dry. Our area, when the sun is out, there's no humidity. There's only like maybe 1 or 2 months out of the whole year that we get a little bit of humidity or it's cold. But otherwise, we can just dry our clothes outside, and I love it. And one time my friend said, so you take them out one at a time from the washer and go hang it outside? It's like, no. I put them in a basket. I take them out to the yard, and then I hang them. I don't take them one. Okay. Taylor says, it says being my obstacle just no nuance is being my obstacle just me self-control problem. We all have those problems. I mean, it's very natural to be difficult to control. But this is the thing. Actually, in somewhere in the printed material, I do have it in there to be ready for criticism. People, because when they see something different, especially something that's not norm to according to the what's happening in the society, people don't agree with it. They don't go along with it. They think that, why are you doing this? This is like, if you don't have the latest iPhone, they'll think that, oh, you're so old. Why are you doing this? So let me ask you this, and they might even laugh at us, but who do you think is going to have the final laugh? Irma is pointing at herself. So,
can I share something?
Absolutely, go ahead.
When I was very young, my father drove a very old car. It was so old, like maybe 40 years old. And it was like, you know, it was so ugly to me. And I just didn't understand, why does he drive these old cars? He would never buy new cars. He would just buy an old used car and he would take care of it for years. The cars would last him forever because he was very responsible about it. And I always felt embarrassed about what he did with his, you know. And then I find out that he was, you know, at that time he was making about $10,000 a year, because I remember on my, you know, applications for college. Mm-hmm. And he had 5 kids, my grandparents and my mom, living in an 1,100 square foot house. Is very small. And he was so thrifty. and he had an 800 credit score. He was never late.
Yep.
Anything. And I felt ashamed because I felt embarrassed that he was so thrifty. But at the end, he took care of everything. There was nothing lacking in our house. So.
Yep. There's, and that's what I really, I don't know why this signed me out. And this is what I always think, that we are going to have the ones who are thrifty. They're the ones who really take care of their finances. We will have the final laugh. That the and the rest of the people that are the spenders, they're spendthrift, they continuously spend. That's when it's like, and some people they do okay. I mean, they don't mind it, but I have seen many people that in their old ages they have to continue to work just to earn a basic living, their basic living. All right. So again, there's this one is, this is toward the end of our program. That would be, oh, here's what I'm going to ask. So if you remember, in for our children, when we do this in our with our students, we give them allowance. So every session, whether it's a weekly session, every 2 weeks or something, we give them some allowance. And the first thing that we do, we give them $20 in allowance, and we give them a stack of bills. And we always ask them to count their money. Now, I want you to be a young child, maybe 10 years old, and I'm supposed to give you $20 in pocket money, but you receive 21. What would you do with that extra dollar? And remember, this is play money, not real money. If I'm supposed to give you 20 and I give you 21, what would you do with that extra dollar? You can put it in the chat, you can unmute yourself. This is a test. What are your thoughts? Maria says, return it to you. Okay. All right. Other thoughts? Man, this is a very quiet group. Vicky says, it's a good practice to always take it back, then use what belongs to you. Okay. So return it again. Yep. All right, but here's the thing. This is play money. So whether I give you 20 or I even give you extra 10, 20, $100, and I usually have a big bag of it. And this is, these are play money. I don't count them. I just tell the students, like, I don't count them. I don't know how much I have. So if you don't return it back to me, I would never know. Does that make a difference, or should we still return it? But does it make a difference that if it's play money, it's okay if I keep it, but if it's real money, it's not okay to keep it? All right, since everybody's quiet. Irma, what do you think? Oh, go ahead, Alcina.
Yes, it does, because the idea is really not the use of the money, but the honesty you are developing.
Mm-hmm. Yep, exactly. And Maria says, you still have to give it back. It's good to always practice honesty. Exactly. And that's how we are able to connect the character traits of honesty and truthfulness with finances. Yes, absolutely right. It, even if I don't know that I give you an extra dollar, but you would know. And if you don't develop the habit based on play money, then how are we going to develop that habit when we are in the real world? So kind of keep that in mind. That's one of the ways we teach honesty to our children. And all right. So the creativity is the last lesson in the basic level. So let me go back to the table of content.
Fine, I just got in. I'm going to work with me something to wear tomorrow. That'll be fine.
Okay. Thank you, Lisa.
All right, and I'll see y'all tomorrow. Thank you so much for your love, and Chris was right on time.
All right, so if you look at our topics in our basic level, and remember, we do the basic level for everyone. We start with human treasures, register book we use every time. I think my video is slow, isn't it? Then we do moderation, responsibility, I should not hover over this. Accountability, thankfulness, respect, generosity, truthfulness, and creativity is the last lesson that we do as part of the basic level. And again, we do the basic level for everyone, but then as you have seen, when we do this for adults, we obviously bring in assets and liabilities, budgeting, investing, retirement. Those are the things that are added on top of the basic level. So let's go to creativity and let's see what kind of talents you guys have. I was hoping to see some talents in our group chat, which Alcina was the only one who posted her talent in there. So thank you so much for being the only one that posted the talent. These are, Alcina, these are shoes that or sandals that you make yourself? Alcina, can you hear me?
Sorry, I couldn't.
That's okay. So the video that you posted on the group chat, those sandals, you make those sandals?
Yeah.
Okay, very good. Wow, those are really nice. So in the group chat, can you tell us, everybody, what are your talents? Let's see what kind of talents we have in the group here.
I didn't get it. Me?
No. This is for everyone. So we saw your talent. Thank you so much for posting your talent. But you were the only one who posted the talent.
Thank you.
So let's see what other talents we have in the group. Wow, everybody is so quiet today. I'm going to put somebody on spot. So if you ever watch this show, that's called either, we have the American version of it, the America's Got Talent, there's the Britain Got Talent. I know a few different countries have got talents. Guess which member of our staff was on America's Got Talent, I think it was 2 years ago, and got the golden buzzer. There you go. Irma was on America's Got Talent, Irma and her choir. Irma, you want to tell us about your choir in your group? You're muted, Irma, you're muted.
Okay, yes, I would love to talk about our choir. Our choir started about 6 years ago because our director, who is a musician, she was walking home one day, and she lives near downtown San Diego, and she was seeing so many people sleeping on the street, you know, on the sidewalk outside, homeless people. And she started talking to them and becoming friends with them. She discovered that a lot of people that are homeless, unsheltered, have a lot of creative talent. A lot of unsheltered people were musicians, singers, actors, dancers, artists, painters, sculptors. She met people from all walks of life that just hit a really bad spot in life. So she decided to start a choir. And so we started getting together and singing. I came in around 5 years ago, I think, 4 years ago. And we started having rehearsals and started singing as a group. And then people started listening to us. And then they started inviting us to sing different places. And the money that we would raise, we would give it to people in the community that needed places to live or needed food for their families. And it just snowballed. And then we were invited to audition for America's Got Talent. And they accepted our audition. And so we went to Los Angeles and they sent us on, they picked us up in a beautiful luxury bus And they took us up to this nice hotel and we spent the night there. And then we got to be on the show the next day. And we won the Golden Buzzer, which is a really huge thing, because if you win the Golden Buzzer, you go straight to the semifinals. So we went straight to the semifinals. But the best thing about it was that people around the world saw us and they were touched. Our song that we sang was very moving, very touching. The stories that our members were telling the world about being unsheltered and the journeys that they've had being unsheltered, and how people have a certain idea about homeless people, but that idea is not always true. A lot of homeless people are very talented. One lady in our choir got her bachelor's degree while she was living on the sidewalk. She was doing her bachelor's degree homework and going to class, and she finished her degree. And so I have great admiration for people that have so much strength. And so that helped us to become very well-known. And a lot of people were helping us with donations and support. And now we have put over 90 people in permanent housing.
Thank you, Irma. And I will post the link to their performance in the group chat. So let's do this. I know everybody's quiet, so we'll try the group, we'll try the breakout room. We'll do the usual 10 minutes. And the topics are, how can you use your talent and passion for a business idea? Have you started doing any kind of business? What do you need to start a business from your talent? And just by seeing how people are not talkative tonight, we'll take the 10 minutes. If you finish early or there's not that many people who want to talk, feel free to come up there sooner than you want. So Irma, I got you in one room, and Judy, I got you in the other room.
Okay.
So it's 42 past the hour. We'll take 10 minutes and then we'll come back. So please go to your breakout room and enjoy. Okay, everybody's back.
Is everybody back?
Yeah, I don't see anybody in the breakout room.
Oh, there's Vicky. I was looking for Vicky. Okay.
Yep, we're back. Okay, Irma, you want to go first with your group?
Sure. We had a really lively discussion about monetizing our creative endeavors. And it was interesting because Dan is a business consultant. And he gives lectures and talks to groups of people that are starting businesses, and it's like he does motivational speaking. So he has found a way to use his talent in business and giving people advice about business, and he generates income from helping people in that way. I thought that was really great, because people really need, especially people that are opening a business, they need a lot of support. So that, I thought that was great. Vicky is a tailor. And I thought, my heart jumped when she told us she has a skill to tailor clothing. And she decided to reach out to young ladies that quit school. And she's teaching them how to be tailors. And when they generate more income, she buys more equipment. She reinvests her creativeness, her creativity, and helping others back into her business. So that is doing two great things. She's building a business and she's helping others, which is a wonderful combination. And Miss Sue from Cambodia is an artist. She's an artist, but she's very shy about her art. She's not ready to share it. because she's a little bit self-critical, but I also explained sometimes artists are very self-critical. They don't see the beauty in what they're creating, but once they show it to the world, it's different because other people appreciate your creativity much more than you could imagine. That's what I have seen. And Miss Soon, the other Miss Soon is an artist too, and I encouraged her to please share her art on our WhatsApp thread. You know, I'm encouraging her just to share a picture or a drawing so that the rest of us can enjoy her creativity.
Yep, very cool. I was actually thinking that just because we didn't do it this week, we can do it next week. I will ask everybody to post their talents. Now, maybe our friends are feeling a little bit more courageous. Mm-hmm. And this is something that we have seen too. I'm sure I've seen it. Both Ms. Judy and Ms. Irma have seen it too. Children often, they want to come and perform their talents, but I literally see the butterflies in their stomach. The one that I clearly remember, it was a third grader. She came to the floor in front of everyone, and this was in front of her own friends. It wasn't like in an assembly or anything. It was just in the classroom. She would come up like four or five times. She came up and she was like holding her stomach. She couldn't do it. And I said, okay, no problem. Go back, sit down, breathe. And then eventually she did it. So yes, it's very natural to be nervous about it. Mm-hmm. Ms. Bank, your group? You're still muted.
Okay, my group was kind of quiet.
Oh.
One gentleman used his education to make more money. I forgot his name.
It's probably Shifa.
Is that?
Oh no, Sophia has a Sophia from Cambodia. He has a franchise business.
Yes,
that's in education.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Alcina, she also, besides selling the shoes, she braids hair.
Wow.
She said, when she has time. I said, you can make a lot of money over in the United States braiding hair. So wherever she goes someplace that she has the time, she's braiding is an art.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, you have to really know what you're doing
yes.
in order to braid hair. But the gentleman, what is his name? I would like for him to tell you guys about his business.
Sophia?
It was Sophia.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it's me, Sophia.
Yeah, tell them what you just told us, share it with them.
Yeah, one of my talent is community mobilization. This is one of the greatest experience that I have with the nonprofit. And recently after COVID is almost ended in Cambodia, I found that more and more people in rural area become in debt of, of the money shaker. And recently I start a new business. We create a company called Pride Capital, where I am helping to educate people in rural area where I am interesting, educate and motivate and empower them to do the saving group. And then I collect the saving money that they save, use as a loan to lend from other to another member of the group and the community with the affordable interest rate. Then this is one part is helping them and one part is a kind of the business as well. And invest some part of that if the company need more capital.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
All right, very cool. So these are all great thoughts. Again, thank you so much for sharing. As you can see, and I think we all have stories to tell, how we might have started our professional life with something that we thought we liked to do. I don't know whether that was becoming a teacher, becoming an engineer, a farmer, or whatever. And then it's interesting where life takes us, how we evolve over time and do different things. And I'm not sure at what age, hopefully we find our passion and use our talents to not only generate funds for ourselves and for our family, but then also to help the community, just as most of you were talking about it. And this is going to be, so this is the wrap up of our program. We have learned a lot together. We have, we started with the finance, with the spiritual aspects of finances. What should be our goal in life, both material and spiritually? And we saw that they are very well connected together. We cannot separate those. Up to now, they've been separated. Either we go to our spiritual, to get spiritual upliftment, whether it's in a temple, mosque, a church, wherever that is. And usually that's isolated by itself. And then we have our personal and family life, our business, our family, and they have not been aligned together. Hopefully through this course, you've seen that we can align them together. They actually have to be aligned together. It's, and this is part of our challenge in our society, is that we're trying to do everything just based on the material aspects of life, whether it's trying to help someone, a community to elevate itself, to become better, to do things better. Material things cannot be the only resources that we have at our disposal. So I'm going to go back to, let me share my screen. Here. So several tabs that we had. So if you remember, we talked about our different types of wealth and resources, that we were born rich with countless number of treasures, these treasures, these character traits that we're all born with rich. Then we gain knowledge throughout our life. We gather talents. Talents is something that I think either we're born with a certain talent or not. Some talents may be acquired, but I think it's mostly like some talents can be discovered. Then we have our physical power, mental, emotional, spiritual powers. And all of these together, let me go into, is what we can use to invest in our society, in ourselves, in our family, in our community, and eventually the entire world. So this is where we bring all of it together. Everything that we have learned, all the different character traits. Let's look, I'm gonna actually go in here. So if you go to our human treasures list, all these character traits that we talked about, remember we learned that we are born like a rock. That diamond is inside of us, but it needs to be polished. It needs to be cut. And the more it becomes polished, that is when the light is shine through us. That is when we see that unlimited different shades of the rainbow color. So by developing these character traits, we can again be healthy ourselves, to our family, to our community and the entire world. And that's where we're gonna bring it all together. is this kind of topic. We talked a little bit about it last time. We said we're hoping to redefine these three different words that are right now only in the dictionary pointing to material aspects of life. Wealth is considered material stuff. Rich, again, is a person that has a lot. And then wealthy, person that has a lot more. That's what, when one of our workshop, when I asked the question, what is the difference between rich and wealthy? It was a group of young adults in their 20s. Somebody said, if you have $2 million, you're rich. If you have $2 billion, you have, well, you're wealthy. And I said, I'll give you 6 months with $2 million, and I'll give you 6 years with $2 billion. And probably most likely it's gonna be gone, because it really has nothing to do with the amount. It's the act. Wealth is our different types of wealth. Rich is the person that has it, and wealthy is the person that knows what to do with it. That's our definition of it. Then we have taken the concept. So probably everybody is familiar with entrepreneurship, right? Or should I ask? Who can tell us what entrepreneurship is? Anybody from the participants want to tell us what entrepreneurship is? I'm sure everybody heard the concept. Nobody? I'm glad that at least in the breakout rooms, people were not quiet. What is the definition of entrepreneurship? Let me go back. We have it somewhere in here. Okay, Maria says business. Okay, we're getting close. I don't have the definition somewhere in there. All right, so no other thoughts. All right, entrepreneurship is basically the action. This is the definition right here. It says the process of developing any enterprise, venture, business from a new concept that has never been tried before. Entrepreneurs take calculated risks without clearly knowing the exact outcome of their efforts. Entrepreneurs possess several characteristics, some of which they are born with, like visionary, good instincts, passion, energy, excitement, persistence, and drive, being fearless and take calculated risks. While other traits are learned, such as high intellect, good communicator, being a good listener, salesperson, team builder, and so forth. Daniel says, ability to identify needs in the community and ability to create a business model out of it. Perfect. Yes, entrepreneurship. So a business owner is someone who has a business that's usually something that other people have done it to. Let's say, for example, a plumber, a carpenter. Now, if they create something, not create just a new product, but a new process of doing things, then that's become entrepreneurship. As it says, entrepreneurship have ideas that they've never, that's the main difference. It is their idea has never been tried before. It's revolutionary. They think something is going to work this way, whether it's a product that they create and they build or a service that they think is going to be really good, but it has risks. So they're willing to put their effort into it to try this thing. And sometimes they use their own resources and sometimes they bring in investment to do this. So that's entrepreneurship. And usually there's a lot of risk. There are many people that start a business and their business just does not pick up even after 4 or 5 years. I was involved in I've been involved in several different businesses from 2004 to 2011. We had a successful business. And then 2016 to last year, we had one that did not succeed well. We lost some money on it. It did not really work out the way we wanted, but we were lucky that at least we were able to recoup some of our money. So there is risk involved in here. Then the other concept that we have come up with, I'm sure you've heard of philanthropy. Philanthropy is when we do things for the greater good of others. We either give our time, not just giving money, because giving money is given a donation. But when we actually get involved and do something, like start a project, and really get involved and do something good for the community, that's what's known as the philanthropy. So I thought I came up with this under philanthropy, but I've seen it in a few other places. So our definition is that we take, as Daniel says, identify a challenge in the community. Take all the different resources that we have learned, we have done with our talents, with our powers, with our different types of wealth, and try to do something good for the community to help it elevate itself, to become a better community, like something that Irma and her choir group have done. A lot of stuff. It can be both a business that generates income, and it can also be something that helps other people. It does not have to be one or the other. In many times, if you have seen people that have become successful in their business ventures, something that they've done good, they do good and then they decide to go help people after they've done well. But our idea is that this process of entrepreneurship starts from a young age, you're even starting this in primary schools. And also the goal from the beginning is to help others. And if you remember, this was part of the scripture that we read in the first week. It basically says, forget your own selves and turn your eyes toward your neighbor. Bend your energies to whatever may foster the education of men. So Daniel put something in there. Let me ask the group, what have you done anything like this? Have you started any kind of project that not only generates income, but also help other people? I think what Vicky shared would be a good example. What Sophia is doing is a good example. Anybody else has an idea about this? Something that you might have seen, either you do yourself or other people have done. Ms. Banks, have you seen anything in this line? While we're waiting for our friends. You're muted.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
So my question is that, have you seen, besides the examples that have been shared, have you seen other people create a venture or something, not only to generate income for themselves, for their family, but also try to help other people?
Well, actually my church right now is opening up a mission for women with children. As a matter of fact, we have two clients that we're signing up tomorrow. And that's to help them. It's not, we're not going to make money off of it, but it's to help them be able to get on their feet, because there's not enough shelters. So we're starting that. It's called House of Hope.
Okay. All right. Very good. Right. Anybody else have any examples to share? Wow, the group has gone very quiet. Okay. Anybody else? Okay. The last thing that we have, I mean, this is something that we can all think about. That there's a lot of things in here. So in the printed version, and we're making some changes in here. So if you remember, we started in the worksheet. Let me go back to the worksheet. If you remember, we started with this tab. It used to be called initial goals, but we changed it to purposefulness. Everybody wrote down their goals, especially here, my spiritual and material goals. Why am I here on earth? What are all this stuff? So once we are done with today's session, we encourage you to go back and visit this first tab that you did before we even started the program. And revisit and see if you want to, you can even add something. So if you had responded, my spiritual material goals are here, in the line below, write down how this program has changed your mind. Have you changed your goals and objectives in life? Are you thinking about doing something different? And your purpose in life, what you thought your purpose is on earth, and maybe through this program, now you have had a different, you have a different thought. You think that, oh, maybe my purpose, and it doesn't necessarily have to be a totally different thing. It can be something, oh, now I have a different understanding. So that's going to be your assignment after today. But it would be really interesting for both you guys and us to see how the program has changed your mindset about how we view life, how we are going to go about our finances and combine our spiritual and material life together. So that's going to be one of the assignments in there. The last thing that we have is a kind of a, what we call this social and economic action development plan, which a lot of you have talked about. It's like, how are we going to make our communities a better place? Maybe you came into this program thinking that, oh, I'm just going to fix my own, not fix, but improve my personal finances. I don't have a budget. I don't know how much money I'm spending. I maybe don't have an investment. I'd like to learn about more about investing and things like that. But we're hoping that in addition to all of that, you've also developed a sense of how can I make my communities a better place? And part of that, if you remember, I'm going to go back into the scriptures that we all read together. Remember the three goals in life for us that's set for those that believe in any of the spiritual guidance from any of the religions is threefold. To know God, worship Him, and attain His presence, to prepare ourselves for the next stage of life, to invest in our future, especially for our soul to continue to live after this life, and then also to be a service to humanity, because that helps our soul grow after we are separated from this body. And this is now what we are thinking about, like how are we going to become a service to humanity? That's the idea of the anthropanthropy. So the idea of social and economic action and develop is what we've talked about, what Daniel said in there. We take a challenge in our community, but there are so many challenges in our community. Where do we even start with? There are some large, there are some small, and where do we begin? And if you remember in the responsibility, we all wrote something in our responsibility. Some of the things that are challenges in our society, whether it's the education. Education is one of the challenges in our local community here. And both Irma and Ms. Banks and I are very familiar. We go to classrooms and students in grade 3, 4, 5, they cannot read, they cannot do simple math. So that's a big challenge for us. Thinking about how you can address some of those challenges. And obviously not by yourself. I mean, some of these challenges are large, some of them are small, but I think we all can allocate some time to identify one small challenge and see what we can do about it. So this plan, this what I'm sharing is, it's a lot of guidelines of how we go about doing this. And as you will see, one of the unique things about this method, there are several unique things, is about engaging the spiritual forces through prayers, by coming together as a community, involving the community together. As we have seen here locally, but also throughout the globe, we have seen many times people or organizations have tried to go into a community and basically tell that community, this is what I think is wrong with you, and this is what I think how you're going to fix it. We have a lot of what we have here in the US is a lot of people are expecting the government to hand out to them or to fix their problems. And yet they're not willing to do anything themselves. They feel entitled that, oh, I need to be served. Who's going to come and serve me? Who's going to help me become better, but they're not willing to do anything. So these are some of the outlines of this. I will share this presentation in the group chat because it's not linked anywhere. It's still under development. So a few of the highlights in here, and then we can take some time to talk and share, is again, there has to be coherence between our physical and material power and civilization and our spiritual power and divine civilization. The challenges that we are seeing in our societies, no matter how small they are, they do have a spiritual root and they do need some spiritual support. Now, what does that mean? To me, at least it means that when I'm trying to do something, I come up with a lot of crazy ideas. Both Emma and Ms. Banks know, I come up with a lot of crazy ideas and I put them into motion, but I don't know if they're right one or not. It all depends on what I had, what I ate night before, or what I ate the week before, as far as what kind of inspiration I come up with. But then I rely on the spiritual forces. If it's something that's supposed to happen, I see progress. I see people coming together and working on it. If it's not supposed to happen, it seems like no matter what I do, it just does not. So I put it aside. I don't necessarily give up on it, but I just put it aside. So really relying on spiritual forces is a key, which we have not done much of it in our societies. And that's kind of following up in that. We really have to, and bringing people together, praying about our challenges, praying to receive confirmation and strength from spiritual forces on the endeavors, because we're trying to make our communities better. We're trying to make our families better. Let's see what else we have in here. Divine Civilization, okay. Kind of talked about it, I want to move on. All right. So there are a lot of challenges in our societies. And this is actually one of the things I love about many of the friends that I have been coming in contact with over this past 17 years. A lot of people, particularly from you outside of US, when I contact them or when they contact us, they actually contact us just like yourselves. A lot of you contacted us directly. They want to do something and they want to go global. And immediately they say, oh, I want to do this and I want to go global. Well, let's start something small. It's great to have that world embracing vision. Yes, we're going to go big, but let's start small, because if you grow too big, too soon, it's almost like a recipe for disaster. And it doesn't matter whether we're doing a business, whether we're doing a community project, starting small and then letting it grow organically. And we have definitely experienced this at Mind Treasures. There's been many times that some of the sponsors have asked me to grow faster. It's like, Alex, how come you're not getting more money? You're not going to more schools. You're not doing this. You're not doing that. And my response has always been that, well, this needs to grow organically. I do my best, but what happens, it's really outside of my control. And that is usually the thing also with entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurs have an idea, they put an idea together, they start it, but how it's going to evolve, it's really, a lot of it has to do with different things, how the economy runs, what is the reaction of consumers to it, and so forth. Let's see, I wanna kind of go through quickly so we can have a breakout session, because I don't wanna just keep on talking. This is one thing that, as I mentioned, a lot of people, unfortunately, on both sides, whether it's an organization, I'm sure everybody has seen, a lot of people go from, let's say, US to different parts of the world, and they say, oh, we are here to fix your problems. I have even seen that here in our communities, that seen organizations or people come to a community and say, oh, this is your problem. These are the things that are commonly used, negative words. We are here to bring you a new financial product. It's an investment or something, or banking services. And yet the community has a lot of other challenges that they need to overcome. And it's really up to the individuals and the families in the community to arise and work together. Of course, at times, professional help is needed, resources are needed, and so forth. Another one. In the old way of doing things, everything was about it's I, me, my, and mine. Especially when we get in the political world. Everything is about, I have so much pride. It's like me, 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 me. Then also it's about who's providing and who's receiving. So in the new world order, we're replacing pride with humility. We are replacing all these I, me, my, we, us, ours, our, and ours. People accompany each other in the field of service and learning. If any of us knew how to fix the problems of the world, we would have already done it. It's very obvious that none of us know. And particularly when I hear the word leadership, this scriptures from the Bible comes to mind. And I think to myself that if a manifestation of God thought that He's here to serve, who are we to say that I want to be a leader? It just does not go well with, but yet you've seen how many programs are there that they talk about raising leaders, raising leadership and doing that. Actually in one of our recent programs, the students came up with the idea of we need to replace the word a leader with exemplar. We need to set examples. for others, not to lead people, but to set examples by our actions, not by our words, but by our actions. So I'm going to stop here because I don't want to just keep on talking about this. Let's go to our breakout session. And the topic is what challenges in our societies? We've talked a little bit about it, but the question is what challenges exist in our communities and how can we utilize everything that we've learned so far trying to address those and who can we partner with, who can we work with? So let me stop sharing. And create the breakout rooms. I'll do a shuffle. Okay. And let me switch some people around. Okay, that's good. All right, guys. So 10 minutes in the breakout room. Again, topic is about challenges in our community and how can we utilize our passion, our talent, everything that we've learned so far, the treasures, investing our skills to address those and get other people involved too. So we'll take 10 minutes and then we'll come back. Okay, everybody's back.
I think I missed one of the people in our group. I think Dan was in our group and I didn't see him until we had finished.
Oh,
okay. So if you could call on him.
That's okay. Whoever would like to share something.
Dan, go ahead and share what you would like to address in your community.
Okay, thank you for giving me the opportunity. I think the biggest challenge that we have is the high level of unemployment. That becomes a problem for many people, for many things that we need. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, so I think promoting and teaching entrepreneurship at all levels of the society is quite key. Because without that entrepreneurial culture, people sit back and expect to be employed, whereas we need to become creators of our own empires, starting something that we can live on, be it a small business, be it a project for the community benefit, be it a big economic activity, but we just have to make sure that we train people and give them the skills to be able to start something and become economically active. That is going to keep many people out of misery, many kids out of the streets, and of course, contributing economically to the well-being of the society and well-being of the country. So promoting entrepreneurship is what I think is the big role that I need to play. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Emma, did you guys have any other discussion in your group?
Yes, Vicky was sharing how, you know, her creative skills and what she's building in Uganda, she is addressing youth unemployment and lack of education because these are young people that are quitting school and, you know, giving them skills, teaching them a skill that they can monetize to have a good, you know, income and build up their lives. That's what she's addressing. And also Alcina also is doing the same thing in Angola with her skills. She's teaching the young ladies in her groups how to make those beautiful sandals so they can make a living. So she's extending her knowledge and her skills to teach others. And Miss Sue from Cambodia, she's going to embark on teaching financial literacy in her community. And that's what she, you know, sees in her future as helping her community by teaching them the skills that she's learning with us. And the other Miss Sue is also, she sent us a message that that she's also going to teach financial literacy, I believe.
Yeah, they're part of in their school. So they are all part of the same school with Sophia. And Sophia is the one that organized this group, actually. So their goal was to learn how to facilitate financial literacy. That was their goal. Okay, thank you so much. Ms. Banks, you're muted.
I know. I didn't have that much of conversation going on, but Sophia Lim said that his challenge in his in where he's from is the economy. And he has a great idea with his company and knowledge is to help the farmers group together and teach them about saving and interest. And he could tell it better than I can. You there?
Sophia's here. Yeah.
Yeah, I am here.
Okay. Tell him how you were talking about helping the farmers.
Okay. As I mentioned earlier that after the COVID-19, several parts of Cambodia affected, suffer from the COVID-19, and especially people in rural areas, they are challenging a lot with the economic crisis, the financial crisis. So to keep their family survival, they are relying their survival on the money of the money shelter. Or the money lender, but they charge very high interest rate, something like 20 to 30% per month, or they borrow $1,000 and then they get only $600, something like that. And there are a lot of informal or we call illegal lender like that. And I found that is serious for the rural community. After I joined the program, I'm starting to launch the idea of because I have experience working with the community and also about community mobilization. And then when I engage with the program of with ABC World, then I think why don't I start something to help them in terms of economic enhancements. And then one way is that, why don't we empower the community to join us a saving group? Because the problem is the saving. They don't really have any saving program in their area, or there is the failed saving program. But why don't we work with them? We start with small, with some group, and then growing to larger community. Then now I'm starting to work with the group of farmers. Combine them as a group, encourage them to combine as a group, and then they start saving, put the money to save, and the money that they are saving is being used to lend to other members of the group. The interest rate is not defined by us, it is defined by the member of the saving group themselves. It's not high and it's affordable, and that charge from the member who borrow the money are used as the saving of the committee of their saving group. And in case some group they need more capital, then my company can invest based on the need, the real need after the family assessment, because we don't lend out the money without family assessment. Our idea is to enhance the economy. So it's not only about lend out money to get interest rate, but to make sure that every single dollar that we lend out is to improve the economic. So assess the need of the family is quite important for us. Yeah, so this is what we are doing to cope with the challenge of the committee that we are working with. Thank you.
All right, very cool. So as you can see, there are a lot of ideas, there are a lot of challenges, there's a lot of energy.
Let's stop.
No.
I think Sophia was done, right? Okay. So there are a few more slides in this that I want to share with you is as all of you were talking about. So addressing these challenges in the community, we cannot be the only one who's taking on the challenge.
phòng chân bộ thả lờ.
I don't know why Sophia keeps unmuting. Okay.
Hello, hello.
Yes, yes.
Can you? Yeah. Did I'm sorry have... because I am on traveling, so sometime internet connection cut.
Okay.
Me.
No problem. Yeah. Did you want to add something?
No. Oh,
okay.
I don't.
All right. Okay. All right, very good. As I was saying, addressing these challenges, we should not feel that we are the only one. And it actually requires universal participation of everyone in the community. Again, here in the US, a lot of neighborhoods or communities, and we've seen, they expect other people to come in and fix their problems. Some people come in and they come, they do something and they leave, and it just doesn't work out. We often underestimate the power of children and youth. But more and more, especially for those that do work with them, schools, and sometimes it takes an outsider to bring out those powers. Often when we go into the classrooms and we bring these topics or these questions and the responses that the students provide, the teachers say, wow, I never thought that my students will have such an idea or such a thought on these things. So it's very powerful. And continuing on, everybody has to be involved, individuals, family, communities, and then of course the institutions needs to be involved as well, faith-based and community organizations, businesses, government, but each one has a place in there. But ultimately, addressing these challenges starts from individuals. We see Sophia has done that, Vicky has a project, this Mind Treasures project. When my wife and I started this 17 years ago, we never thought that this would be a global program, but now we see that it is. We continue to build capacity within ourselves. Not everyone can all of a sudden start and saying, well, this is what we have, this is the problem. It takes some time and it's okay. We often really get stuck on outputs. Especially for us here in the US, when we seek sponsorship, we get it from businesses, from organizations, and from governments. It seems like when we get sponsorship from government, they're only concerned with outputs. How many people, what are their names? And they really don't care about what the outcome is, which is the accomplishment. What did the participants actually accomplish? What did they do? And it's very easy to just get consumed with numerical values, statistics, number of participants, how many sessions, how many hours. But really, we have to look and see, well, this project that we did, what are the accomplishments, the participants? What was the learning? What did we learn through this process? It was not a failure. If something did not work out, hopefully, we don't look at it as a failure. I think throughout this series, several times people have said, well, I failed in this or I failed in that. Well, we should not look at it as a failure, but rather a learning process. And there is one, I thought I had it in here, but there is something that particularly in US, and I'm not sure if it's in other places, other parts of the world or not, people and governments and organizations would love to label people and community with negative words. Here in US, people love to label, they would call the communities, the underserved community, the at-risk youth, or unbanked, or underbanked. Judy, Irma, what else, what other kind of negative words you've heard? Labels that are being put on communities to describe them, instead of describing them as the positive, they're always described in a negative way, like underserved, at risk,
impoverished,
low income. While these are realities that do exist. Underserved, I don't know. That one is like, because we feel like we should always be served. But if we just look at the community or individuals in the negative side, the level of income, then we are forgetting about their accomplishments, their culture that they have, their assets that they have. So those also should be, and we actually did a 2-hour workshop in one of the universities here with one of our other staff members, Ms. Nari Cooper, that it was just concentrate that we need to change that mindset. It's very unfortunate that this mindset actually comes from the United States federal government. Basically, any organization or individual who is trying to get sponsorship from the federal government, if you do not use those words, those negative words, that means you do not get any money. But that is something that you're trying to change. At the local level, we have seen some changes with our district attorney, because our district attorney is very much involved with trying to help youth not get into trouble and get into the judicial system. And they already agreed that, yes, we can eliminate those wards. It's a long process, but we can definitely do that. So these are the different things. I'm sure you can come up with a lot of other topics, a lot of other things, but I want to stop here. We got about 10 minutes left. And before we completely wrap up, I want to see if there are any questions about what we've done over this past 6 weeks, any of the topics, anything that was not clear, or you have questions. Of course, as I mentioned, this is not the end of it. We will continue to work as long as you have questions, you need help. Remember, the budgeting process, it's not just a one-time thing. We created a budget for the entire year. We have to do it every month. As long as you're willing to do it, you're here to help through the WhatsApp group or for our friends that are, we've already met with some of the friends here locally to try to help them with their questions. So I'm going to stop here. See, first of all, if Irma and Ms. Banks have anything to add, and then if anybody has any questions before we wrap up the series. Any thoughts, questions? Well, everybody's ready to finish. We're sad that some of our regulars could not be here tonight, but they did send me a message. The only one who did not message me was Kiza from Uganda. I don't know what happened to him, but Faisa and also did tell me that they could not make it tonight. Okay, it's like you're quiet. That means you're done. Well, thank you so much, everyone, for spending time with us. Really, thank you to Ms. Banks and Ms. Irma. Daniel couldn't, Donald couldn't make it tonight. There was no sign of him. But really appreciate everyone waking up early in the morning. I know Alcina and Dan, it was your early morning. So really appreciate the dedication. And hopefully we will pray for your success, both in your personal life and the endeavors that you're taking to disseminate this information to other members of your community. And we are here to support you with whatever you need. All right. Well, thank you very much. Have a good day, everyone. And we'll see you guys. We'll talk later.
Thank you for everything.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. And bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.